And welcome back, Chad Holmes Show, here on Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bullfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. Again, you can also join us by going to our Facebook or X page. Go to facebook.com or x.com, search out Bull Falls Radio. You can join us there. Also, make sure you write down this number, because if you want to call or text, if you have any response to what myself or Oliver Burrows had to say outside the bubble, if you have any thoughts on the news of the day, again, there's a lot of news going on, as Oliver said, internationally, but also in terms of local, state, national, whatever it may be, you can give us a call at 715-382-9297. That's 715-382-9297 to join us here on the program. Before we go any further, need to again say good morning to our in-studio engineer and producer, Ian Welsh. Ian, good morning.
Good morning, Chad.
Again, it sounded like you had a good weekend. I enjoyed myself as well, as I said. Mm-hmm. I want to tell you, I had a little bit of stress on Saturday, though. Late in the afternoon, I went shopping. I went to the supermarket. I went to a Pick and Save near where I live in Weston.
Okay.
And, I'm going around and something annoys me about some of these places. And again, I know why they do it. They do it to get information and all this stuff. But they call it digital coupons, you know, where instead of just saying, hey, this is on sale, and then you go through and it automatically goes through, they have what are called digital coupons. You have to get your phone out. You have to take a scan of the code, and you have to have the app, and then it automatically then will take off the money in terms of when you check out.
Yeah, not everybody likes to do that. Not everybody knows how to do it,
and
easy to figure out. I just use my Pick and Save Perks card.
Well, that doesn't. I mean, if I wanted to get $5 off each of my cases of soda, I had to use the because it was a digital coupon. It doesn't work otherwise. I mean, it doesn't. So,
and not everybody knows how to use the little QR code, a scanner you can put on your phone.
Exactly. So I did that. So I get through and I go there and I go through the checkout and it all worked fine. I mean, it was all good. But when you do that, what I do is I take my phone out and I just put it on this little top thing near where you push the cart, because I knew I was going to need that scan thing. So I get through there and I get done and I take my stuff out. I get home, I unpack, and then all of a sudden I realize I don't have my phone.
Oh, no.
So I left my phone apparently sitting on top of the cart, and I'd taken the cart out because I loaded the stuff into my car, and I put the cart in the little return area. And so it was basically about 10 to 15 minutes, because I live very close to the Pick and Save, so it's like only about 3 minutes away. So I get right after I get home, and I realize I don't have my phone, so I go right back, and I go back to where I had my cart, and there's nothing there. I go inside, and I go to the customer service, and they say, well, no, nothing has been put through. And he goes, well, if you give me another number, if we find it, we'll give you a call. I don't have another number. That's my only phone. I do have a hard line at home, but I don't know what the phone number is. It's part of the bundle. I have cable. I have a Charter bundle. I have internet, cable, and a phone. But I never use my hard line. I have no idea what the phone number is. I mean, I would probably go home now and call up and you'll show on my phone what the number is. I'll do that. But then, because he said, well, I said, well, there's nothing I can do. So I said, well, I'm getting all flustered at this point. So I say, well, I'm just going to take a look around and go to the other, to the areas where all the carts are. Maybe somebody brought it in and, and then I go back outside. Again, I'm saying, well, maybe I went to the wrong area and missed it. And then somebody else is coming. One of the workers is going out to clear out the carts.
Okay.
And I said to him, "Well, I said, had you seen any? had you picked up a phone in one of these carts? He said, no, well, I'm going to go in there and I'll ask some of the other folks. And he goes in there and I'm just hanging out. And then he comes back and says, is this your phone? I said, yes, it's my phone.
Oh, thank goodness.
So he went beyond the call. He did what he had. I mean, I was so thrilled because I thought, man, I can't lose my phone. I'm completely lost without my phone. Like everything is on my phone. It's like, It would have been horrible if, because I mean, heck, I mean, you and I, we put in our hours on my phone, on our phone. You have your phone, I have my phone. You know, when I do
that's
a game,
right.
I put my hours, my special game broadcast to get paid for. You know, so it's like everything is on my phone. But it all started because of those doggone digital coupons. And the thing was,
it's worth, huh?
Thing was, it's, you know, it saved me $25, so I had to use it because the price for the 12 packs of soda were $9.99, but if you had the digital coupon, they were only $4.99. So I mean, it was crazy. So that was my Saturday. And it was really warm Saturday afternoon. That was the day it was like
yes,
in the 80s.
Was.
So adding that to the warmth, I was dripping by the time I got home, sweating because I was so, you know, nervous and, you know, trying to get my, you know, all the stress of trying to find my phone. And ultimately I was finally able to find it. So again, thanks to that worker and thanks to the folks at Pick and Save, they were all very nice in terms of trying to help me find my phone. And I was just glad somebody didn't take it, you know, and walk off with it and have my phone.
Yeah, it seems like those QR codes are getting very popular. I know that in some restaurants and coffee shops, like they have, like, instead of the paper menus, they have, like, you scan the code and you can get the menu on your phone. But it's like, you know, not everybody wants to do that because everybody, well, some people actually like to, you know, hold the menu in their hands, look at the different options. If you have, like, a printout menu, the text is a little bigger so you can actually see it better. Trying to see it on your phone when it's very tiny. I mean, it's not for everybody. But I understand that they're trying to save on paper, but, you know, sometimes it's a good thing, and sometimes, you know, it's not for everybody. So you just got to pick your battles and choose wisely, I guess.
And there's a lot of, I mean, nowadays I've gone to some restaurants recently where now you can basically scan and get your bill. You don't have to have the waitress come over and give you the bill and go then pay it. And the thing about that I find interesting, in fact, they do it at the Mint now, and the Mint's just down the road here from our radio station. So once in a while, I'll go have lunch at the Mint.
Well, they do it at Mint now, too?
Yes, they do at the Mint. And the thing about it I find interesting is, okay, you know, I the first time I did it, it felt really weird because I scanned it and I paid it and I was all done. And then I walked out and left. I'm thinking, How would anybody here in the store know for sure that I paid it?
Yeah, that's something you have to double check before you leave, because then you just might.
No, but
you
I
might
mean,
get in trouble.
No,
if you
the,
think that you didn't
but,
pay for
but,
it.
But I mean, the folks that, you know, they see, you know, somebody walk out without going to the front and paying the bill or paying it through the waitress, I'm thinking, how do they know that I'm just not walking out, not paying my bill? It's just odd, but they apparently must have some sort of electronic system that says, okay, this table paid its bill, so no problem, head off. But it's just, you know, the technology just continues to be, you know, just continue so very quickly. Things change so quickly these days. And as I get older, it's like I just shake my head. And I'm thinking, I'm just glad I'm not dealing with this because I'm old enough where back when I was going to school, I graduated in 1989 from DC Everest. And back then, we didn't have the phones. We didn't have email. We didn't have social media. I'm thinking nowadays, how do these kids do it? I'm around these kids a lot with the coverage of high school sports. I'm thinking, how do you deal with all of this technology? Everything is technology now, and it just changes so very quickly. And as we get older, it's harder to keep up with it. But I think the younger kids and people that deal with it on a regular basis, I think it's a lot easier. But I feel like, man, I'm just glad I did not have to deal with it when I was going to school, because I can't imagine going through your school day having to deal with all the technology. I know there's some schools that have rules where it's like you're not allowed to have either phone. I don't know what the rules are, but not be on, you know, social media and all this stuff during the course of the school day. But how do you keep track of all this? I mean, there's so much that you need to keep track of these days. And I just sometimes wish, come on, let's this AI scares me to death. I wish we were not dealing with this. I'm an old fuddy-duddy, I think, sometimes when it comes to technology. How do you look at it? I mean, I think when you're going to school, obviously,
it's just,
you were dealing with it in school. Did you?
I mean, I'm going to date myself here, but it's not like that old. I graduated from Everest
in
2012. And this was like 12 years ago. And back then, you know, Facebook and Twitter, you know, back when it was called Twitter, were the main things. Like, we didn't have, like, actually, I think Instagram and Snapchat were around as well, but I think Snapchat kind of lost its touch over the years after that, and then TikTok came around a few years after that. But it's like, you know, back when I was in high school, well, not everybody was, like, so focused on their phones or the technology. It's like, we still had a lot of, you know, face-to-face interactions. We were still talking, like, face-to-face. It's not like we were staring down our phones all the time, but it's just, no, I agree that the technology has changed very rapidly, and with the evolution of AI in recent years, it can be a little scary, because AI is becoming very, you know, dependent on, you know, well, I'm trying to see how to say this. It's becoming, you know, a part of people's lives, and sometimes they don't even know it. Like, it's, you know, AI is working, I can do all this amazing stuff, like write a story or just.
Well, it takes away intellectual, you know,
it
number
takes
one.
Away your creativity.
Right.
For one thing.
It's like, you know, where are some of these opportunities going to go when you can just use AI instead of human beings?
There's
a lot of scary aspects to it, and I think in a lot of ways it's not going to be something that is positive for humanity as we go into the future. But
just remember all those movies about AI people. They tried to warn us.
Well, Terminator 3, Rise of the Machines. The machines take over. You know, the machines are taking over. So hopefully not. Hopefully we'll be able to stay ahead of the curve. But
hopefully humanity can be smarter than humanity in movies.
Maybe that'd be nice. The time is 9:18. Coming up, we're going to talk a little sports. Again, bring back, a bit of sad news. If you missed it earlier, Jim Otto, Wausau native, legend in the NFL, he passed away. We'll talk a little bit more about Jim Otto and sports coming up here as we continue on this Monday morning. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Home show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at bowfallsradio.com. Mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO. And on the Civic Media app. Again, 58 degrees right now in downtown Wausau. It's brightened up considerably since I drove in this morning. It was so dark. The rain was coming down hard. In fact, every time I kind of woke up during the overnight hours, I could hear that rain pounding down. But we got a little bit of an opening right now, but it doesn't mean we're not going to see more rain. In fact, if you missed our discussion with Brittany Merlot earlier today, there's going to be a lot of rain between later today, tonight, tomorrow night. Lots of rain. In fact, a chance of some severe storms tomorrow, especially in the afternoon. So we'll keep you up to speed on the weather as we continue throughout the day and the night on Bow Falls Radio and the Civic Media Radio Network. Milwaukee Brewers still in first place in the National League Central. The Brewers are 27-19, two games ahead of the Chicago Cubs in the division. Could have been three games, but the Brewers fell yesterday 9-4 in Houston. So the series went to the Astros 2-1. Brewers really struggled yesterday. Colin Ray gave up 5 runs on 8 hits and 4 walks in 4 1/3 innings. By that point, the game was really out of hand. The Brewers did try to come back. I mean, they were down by 5 at that point, 6-1. But then they did score 3 times in the 7th to make it 6-4. But then Houston really put it away in the bottom half of the 7th inning, scoring 3 times. Bryce Terang and Christian Yelich each had 2 RBI for Milwaukee. So the Brewers, 27-19, continue what is their longest road trip of the season. They'll be heading down south, taking on the struggling Miami Marlins, one of the worst teams in baseball so far this year. They will start a 3-game series in South Florida tonight. In fact, the Marlins, they've been playing better recently. They got off to just a horrid start, and they're still 18 games under 500. They're 15-33, but they've been playing at more of a break-even level recently. So the Marlins and the Brewers tonight opening up that series. We are now heading into a big week in terms of high school sports. The high school softball playoffs continuing, and we start our high school playoff coverage tomorrow, and hopefully tomorrow. Again, the weather not looking all that hot for tomorrow. Tomorrow we're scheduled to have a pair of high school softball playoff broadcasts. The Wausau West Warriors in Division 1 in a regional semifinal. Number 9 seed Wausau West at number 8 seed Menominee. And we will have live coverage of that one tomorrow, starting with the pregame show at 4:50 and the first pitch at 5 p.m., weather permitting. And also tomorrow, Tom Weaver will be heading over to Marathon as the Marathon Red Raiders are going to be in action. Marathon starting off their playoff run, the Marathon Red Raiders in Division 4. They are a number 4 seed, so the Red Raiders getting a playoff at home to start things off. And Marathon will be in action playing host to Princeton. Hang on a second. The name of the school, it slips my mind here. Marathon is at home tomorrow. That's what I'm going to say. In Division 4 in terms of the state softball playoffs. Doggone it. I should have had this information right in front of me. But the Marathon Red Raiders, Tom Weaver, will have the broadcast live on the Sports 2 stream of BowFallsRadio.com and the Civic Media app. So again, if you want to catch a Marathon live, 4:50 for the pregame, 5 o'clock for the first pitch, download the free Civic Media app. It's really a terrific app, really fantastic to be able to get both the Wausau West and Marathon games live tomorrow. And the Marathon Red Raiders taking on Princeton Green Lake. There you go. Princeton Green Lake, number 5 seed against number 4 seed Marathon. Tom will have it live, 4:50 for the pregame, 5 o'clock for the first pitch on the Sports 2 stream of the Bull Falls Radio page on the Civic Media app, or else by going to BowFallsRadio.com and just clicking on Sports 2 stream as well. I hope you got that. But again, we are very proud to be the only Wausau radio station still bringing you live coverage of high school sports on the radio, BowFalls Radio 98.9 and 1230. Also, again, want to remind you that last night we had heard the news, sad news, that Wausau native and Pro Football Hall of Famer Jim Otto died last evening. The Raiders announced that in a statement. Jim Otto was 86 years old. Otto was a graduate of Wausau High School back in 1956. He was a two-way standout, both as a center on the offensive side and a linebacker on the defensive side under legendary head coach Win Brockmeyer. He then went on to play pro football for 10 years in the American Football League with the Oakland Raiders and then stayed with the Raiders for another 5 years in the NFL. He was one of only 20 players ever to play in all 10 seasons of the American Football League. And Jim Otto never missed a game due to injury, which is an amazing record in football, especially during that era. He played for the Raiders from 1960 through 1974. He was a man that was respected by Al Davis and the entire Raider ownership. They kept him on as part of the organization after he retired for many years. If you looked up in the press box where Al Davis or his son Mark Davis, who succeeded Al Davis as owner of the Raiders, who would be sitting next to Al Davis? Jim Otto. Who would be sitting next to Mark Davis? Jim Otto. He was always there with the Raiders. He was one of the cogs. He was known as Mr. Raider. I mean, he truly was the man with so many other superstars with the Oakland Raiders over the years. And Jim Otto was really the heart, the soul, the foundation of that franchise. And again, he was there from the beginning. The American Football League. What? And Jim Otto was fortunate. He was not drafted in the NFL. The NFL missed completely on Jim Otto, but the American Football League was forming in 1960. The Oakland Raiders signed him, and then he played every single game for 15 seasons. Just an amazing story, and he came right here from Wausau. Again, Wausau High School, Wynn Brockmeyer. Incredible story. And the last 86 years... He had so many health issues, and it weren't just because of his football either. He was believed to have undergone more than 50 operations, most because of football-related injuries, some not, but again, the pounding that he took over those years. 50 operations, multiple joint replacements, arthritis, debilitating back and neck problems. His right leg was amputated in 2007. What a tough, tough man. What a great, great man. What a great, great football player. And what a great representation of Central Wisconsin and the Wausau area. So, Jim Otto, we're going to hear more about Jim Otto over the next number of days, I'm sure. And his story will continue to be told. He was elected in his first year of eligibility to the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1980. So, a fond farewell to a great Wausonian, Jim Otto. The time is 9:28. Coming up, we're going to talk about some of the issues I talked about with Oliver Burroughs outside the bubble previously. Again, some things I heard this weekend from Republicans and conservatives on the national weekend shows. Going to go into that realm coming up after, again, news, weather, and sports information update is straight ahead. The time is 9:29. Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, BullFallsRadio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. And again, you can catch us on our video stream by going to Facebook.com and also X.com. Be able to see us, see our smiling faces, be able to join us as well with comments. You can comment on the Facebook and X page, and you can also give us a call. You can join us on the program. You can call us or text us. The call and text line are the same. So 715-382-9297. That's 715-382-9297 to either call us or text us and let your voice be heard. And of course, I hope you tuned in earlier with our Outside the Bubble, because it's interesting to kind of go into some of these, I think, bigger issues going on more of a national feel and go from a different point of view. Because one thing that I try to push back on, and I saw Oliver try to almost both sides it again a little bit, and again, I don't blame him at times, because that's what a lot of folks on the right are doing. But the idea that the fissures that are going on right now when it comes to the system is somehow a both sides problem, it's a Donald Trump problem. And it's turned from a Donald Trump problem into a Republican Party problem, because so many folks on the right and members of the Trump Republican Party, the MAGA Republican Party, are basically trying to say, Donald, see, I'm with you. I'm with you all the way. No matter what you say, I'm with you. Instead of saying, Donald, no, you have no proof here. Donald, no, you're hurting the system. You're hurting the country. Donald, stop it. And we saw more of that this weekend. And I wanted to delve a little bit more into this, again, this what we heard on some of the national programs. The incredible amount of force that it's taking for these GOP members to stay on the good side of Donald Trump. And the amount of Republicans now that are refusing to say that they will accept the results of an election. When you think about it, it's amazing. This country, for 200 plus years, coming up on 250 years, we have had conservative parties or liberal parties. We've had basically the Republicans and the Democrats since 1856. The election of 1856 was the first time that it was Republicans and Democrats. And back then, John C. Fremont was the Republican nominee for President of the United States. James Buchanan was the Democratic nominee for President of the United States. Then in 1860, Abraham Lincoln as Republican was elected. But basically, since that point, we've had two parties. It's been a two-party system. And sometimes we've had Republicans be elected. Sometimes we've had Democrats be elected. In fact, for the most part, there usually is either every two terms in terms of the White House, you see a changeover. Sometimes it'll take three terms, maybe. And then on the outside, it was four and five terms when during the FDR Truman era. But for the most part, you rarely see three consecutive terms of the same party in power. We saw that with Reagan and George H.W. Bush. But other than that, it's always been basically flipping back and forth. You had two terms of Eisenhower, then two terms of JFK and LBJ. You had two terms of Nixon and Ford, then a term of Carter, then three terms of the Republicans, but then two terms of Clinton, two terms of W. Bush, two terms of Barack Obama, and then one term of Trump, and now one of the first term of Joe Biden. But the system, you respect the voters. You respect that the voters, sometimes in this country, will go one direction or the other. But then Donald Trump came. And as I mentioned in the last hour, every time Donald Trump loses an election, and it can be even in a Republican caucus, like in the Republican caucuses of 2016, Donald Trump lost to Texas Senator Ted Cruz in the Iowa caucuses of 2016. And he said, it was fixed. It was rigged. He really won. I mean, this craziness. But now we have others that are on this train. And Marco Rubio is, I think, one of the poster children for where the Republican Party has gone. And he had an embarrassing discussion with Kristen Welker on Meet the Press yesterday. Marco Rubio now thinks that after Donald Trump called him Little Marco during the 2016 election, when Donald Trump walked all over him during the 2016 election cycle, the Republican primary cycle, Marco Rubio now thinks that he has a chance to become Donald Trump's vice president. So Marco Rubio is now trying to say and do anything in order to gain the favor of Donald Trump. And yesterday, Rubio would not come out and say that the 2020 election was fair or that he will accept the results of the 2024 election. It was pointed out by Kristen Welker on NBC yesterday that Marco Rubio did vote to certify the results of the 2020 election. He said in early 2021 after the insurrection that, yes, the election was fair. But now he will not say that. Also, another flip-flop that Marco Rubio made is talking about Donald Trump's mass deportation policy. During the election cycle of 2016, he had said that he was against it. He opposed it. But now he says We have to do something dramatic. Really? We're going to have to do something dramatic when it comes to deportations. Marco Rubio says he supports Trump's plan to round up migrants and send them to detention camps. Did you ever think we are going to get to the point in this country where millions and millions of people are going to vote for a man that wants to have detention camps in this country? Or that we would see numerous elected officials from one of the major political parties say that, yeah, let's round them up and send them to detention camps. And again, it's a flip-flop. Rubio is kowtowing to Trump because he has no spine. He has no courage. Also, this weekend, to hear the folks that are bending over backwards to agree with Donald Trump. Just bending over. I mentioned in our Outside the Bubble segment about Senator J.D. Vance. Senator J.V. Vance, before he ran for office, was as big a never-Trump person in the Republican Party that there was. But then when he realized he needed Donald Trump in order to be elected senator, to win the Republican primary for senator, and then ultimately become the senator in Ohio, he completely turned face. And now he can almost taste becoming vice president of the United States. And yesterday on Face the Nation, J.D. Vance was asked a question. Viktor Orban. Again, the Turkish dictator, a fascist, has seized control of universities and put them in foundations that were run by his allies. He rewrote the Constitution. He neutered the courts and he has tried to control the media. Is that what you're advocating for in the U.S.? J.D. Vance was asked that. And instead of saying the obvious answer, no, absolutely not. This is the United States of America. We don't do that here. How did J.D. Vance answer that question? He said, quote, I think he's made smart decisions that we could learn from in the United States. Mark Jacob appears on Up North News Radio with Pat Kreitlow every Friday morning. I really enjoy Mark Jacob. I enjoy following him on social media. I enjoy reading what he has to say. Mark Jacob is an ex-editor at the Chicago Tribune and the Chicago Sun-Times. And he is very straightforward when it comes to how the media is covering, I would call it fascism in the United States. And yesterday morning, Mark Jacob, after seeing J.D. Vance on Face the Nation, tweeted with the copying what Vance had said. He said, how many different ways do Republicans need to tell you that they want a fascist dictatorship before you'll believe them? And they keep saying it. They keep saying it over. And yet people, and especially way too many members of the media seem to say, Trump will pivot at some point. And that's the scary aspect. Take them for what they're saying. Donald Trump this weekend, again, said it all out loud. He was at the National Rifle Association national meeting this weekend. And he got in front of the NRA and said, and he proudly said this. He said, after the school shootings during his administration, there were a lot of people who wanted things done to try to make sure that they would not happen again. And Donald Trump proudly told the NRA, he said, and what did we do? Nothing. And people cheered. After shootings that took away young people, killed them. After other mass shootings in other areas of our society, when people are saying something needs to be done, Donald Trump proudly goes in front of the NRA and said, What did we do? Nothing. Nothing. Donald Trump in the past number of days said, if Democrats take control of both the White House and both houses of Congress, they will pass legislation that will codify the protections of Roe v. Wade. And, you know, he actually told the truth. He told the truth. That's right. Let's believe people. Trump said, he said this at the NRA last night, or this weekend, if the Democrats get their way, they will pass a federal law protecting abortion rights. That's what we should be talking about. What will Donald Trump do? What will Republicans do? What would Joe Biden do? What will Democrats do? There are a lot of issues out there that we should be discussing. And yet, too much of the media is playing these games. Election night in America. Let's get the round table together. Debate night in America. I really am proud of the president for saying no to the commission this time around in terms of these debates. And I frankly don't think we should have debates at all. I thought they were useless last time around. But maybe we'll get more out of them this time. But those were basically sporting events.
Debates have turned into a shouting match between two people where nobody's civilized anymore.
Yes. They're shows.
Personally, to me.
And crowds. We don't need crowds. There should be nobody in the studio except the candidates and the moderator.
I agree. The studio should be completely empty.
There should not be cheering. Because then, all of a sudden, it feels like the candidates have to say things to get some cheers. No. So, again, this weekend, we, again, are learning where they want to go with this country. Believe them, as Mark Jacobs said. Believe them. Well, coming up, we will start a new week of our quiz with Ian Welsh. We'll
That's
see
right.
if we can get the number of the day correct, get off to a good start, and we'll have our daily history lesson as well. The time is 9:49, Chad Holmes Show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, BowFallsRadio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO. And on the Civic Media app, it is May the 20th of 2024. That means it's day number 141 of this year. There are 225 days remaining this year. And some famous events have been happening on this date in history. In 1873, Levi Strauss and Jacob Davis received a patent for blue jeans with copper rivets. People know of Levi Strauss. You don't really hear much about Jacob Davis. Levi Strauss, more famous. 1916, the small town of Codell, Kansas was struck by a tornado. Incredibly, the same town was also hit in 1917 and 1918 on the exact same date. On this date in 1927, famous day, Charles Lindbergh took off from Roosevelt Field in Long Island, New York, on the world's first solo nonstop flight across the Atlantic Ocean, touching down at Le Bourget Field in Paris the next day. 5 years to the day after that, in 1932, Amelia Earhart took off from Newfoundland to begin the world's first solo nonstop flight across the Atlantic Ocean by a female pilot. She landed in Ireland the next day. On this date in 1993, to celebrate the final episode of Cheers on NBC, Jay Leno did The Tonight Show live from Bull and Finch Bar most of the Cheers cast who appeared on that show appeared to be drunk. On this date in 2015, yep, hard to believe. I remember watching this and hoping that the show would not end because I was saddened by the end. But 9 years ago today, on May the 20th of 2015, David Letterman, after 33 years, hosted his last late-night talk show. And it was a great, great finale and a great, great ending. And on this date in 2018, K-pop boy band BTS became the first Koreans to perform at the Billboard Music Awards. Some famous people are celebrating their birthdays today. Cher turned 78. Actor Dave Thomas of SCTV fame, also Grace Under Fire, is 75. Bronson Pinchot of Perfect Strangers and also Beverly Hills Cop is 65 years old today. Actor John Billingsley of True Blood and Enterprise is 64. Actor Tony Goldwyn of Scandal is 64 as well. Mindy Cohn from Facts of Life played Natalie on the Facts of Life. Mindy Cohn is 58. Actor Timothy Oliphant of Justified, Deadwood, and Santa Clarita Diet, 56 years old today. And rapper Busta Rhymes is 52. If you're out there celebrating your birthday, happy birthday to you from all of us at Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Some special events being acknowledged today and this week. This week, it is EMS, Emergency Medical Services Week. It is International New Friends, Old Friends Week. It is Unicycle Week, so get on your unicycle today. It is Backyard Games Week. It is Safe Boating Week. World Schizophrenia Awareness Week. Healthy and Safe Swimming Week. Seatbelt Reinforcement Week. Rescue Dog Day. Streaming Day. Pick Strawberries Day. Weight and Measures Day. World Bee Day. World Flower Day. It is Be a Millionaire Day. Flower Day. Red Sneakers Day. And Quiche Lorraine Day. Okay. All right. It is time. It is time to start the week off with a big W if you're yes. Ian Welsh. Because at the end of every show, we have the number for the day. And what we do is we give Ian Welsh three choices. And based on that, you should get one out of every three right, which is 33%. If you're above normal, then you're above 33%. That's a winning week. If you're below that, then it's a losing week.
Yeah.
And last week, it was a 25% week because we had one day we didn't do it. One out of four. So you got to get back on the winning track this week.
That's right.
Are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Are you going to go with your gut? Are you going to think about it? What are you going to do? What, you got a
I'm
plan?
I'm going to go with my gut this time. I'm not going to overthink it.
All right. Our number for the day. You're familiar with Q-tips, right?
Yes, I am.
Q-tips are very popular.
Oh, yes.
Very popular around the world. And our number for the day is the number of Q-tip cotton swabs sold each year.
Each year.
And this is the number of one because you buy packages, there's more than one in the package. And this
quite
is
a few of them.
Around the world. Yep. How many Q-tip cotton swabs are sold each year?
Okay.
Is the correct answer 12 billion cotton swabs are sold each year? Is the correct answer 22 billion cotton swabs are sold each year? Is the correct answer 32 billion swabs sold each year? They're all big numbers.
Oh, yes.
12 billion, 22 billion, 32 billion Q-tip cotton swabs sold each year.
There's quite a few of them in a package, and this is every year.
Every year, all around the world.
I'm going to go with C. I'm going with 32 billion, going with the biggest number.
Going with the biggest number
here.
My
final answer. I'm going with my gut on this
one. All right.
So
you're fine. You can't change, though. You said it.
Nope. Can't change.
It's your final answer.
Yes.
The number of Q-tip cotton swabs sold each year, 32 billion.
Yes. A good way to start off a Monday.
You're one for one, 100% so far this week.
Oh. boy.
So that means we have to skip one more the rest of the week, and then you're a winner. So so there you go. Congratulations.
Good on that one. I didn't overthink that answer.
That's a great way.
It had to be more than $12 billion.
Why did you know that? Why? I mean, why did you know that? I have no idea why did you know that.
Well, Q-tip packages have a lot in them. And like you said, they're very popular. And this is
but
the
$12 billion would still be a lot.
A year. I mean, 32 a billion seems the most. Like, I was debating between B and C.
Okay. All right. Well, no matter how you did it, you got it right. So
exactly.
Well, we'll be back tomorrow. Thanks to Oliver Burrows for joining us earlier today. Stick around. Matt and Air on Air. Bach and Matt and Air. So it'll be a lot of fun from 10 until noon.
Happy Monday, everybody.
Yep. Thank you, Ian. Have a great night, and we'll talk to you tomorrow.
You too, Chad.
This has been the Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230.